Hello and good evening. This is the day of the federal budget being handed down in Australia. And it's an opportunity for us also to look at the context of the budget, but also really focus on some of the short-term issues that we're facing as a country and how they're going to play into the long-term considerations that we all have for the future health and prosperity of the nation. This is the third installment in the series ADC Forum is running on understanding and moving on from COVID-19. And this update series has today's discussion focusing on the economic legacy of COVID-19. We're going to be looking at issues such as the impact of the pandemic on the global and the Australian economy from the short to the long term, the impact on small business and jobs, and how to help survival in this critical sector, what some of the long-term viable policy options might be, and also how is economic thinking changing as a result of COVID-19 in terms of the assumptions and also the approaches and what might be up for challenge. We'll also look at how the Australian economy will be rebuilt and the debt that is being accumulated at this point in time, how that's going to be paid in coming years. And joining us, we have Professor Bob Officer, who's the chairman of Acorn Capital and expert in financial economics. He also studied under Milton Friedman, actually, at the University of Chicago. We've got Anatole Kaletsky, chair of Gavekal, and he is coming to us from the UK, an expert in economics and economies around the world. Also, Professor Gigi Foster from the UNSW Business School and 2019 Young Economist of the Year. We have Jack Dwyer, who's the CEO of Conduit Capital, arriving back this year from the UK. He's a fund manager and spent the last 11 years investing for George Soros. And also Jeremy Wilson, the chairman of the Whitechapel think tank, which focuses on distributed ledger technologies. So I might actually ask Bob Officer to start the discussion this evening. I think it's pertinent to have an Australian perspective in terms of what's happening tonight. So without further ado, over to you, Professor Bob Officer.
And I'll give a bit of background. We're obviously in a recession, first for nearly 30 years. The Australian economy shrank by about 7% in the 3 months to June, following about a 0.3% drop in the March quarter. It was the second consecutive quarterly contraction and the sharpest on record. We've yet to see the September quarter numbers, but we expect them to be worse, not better. It's, in fact, not expected GDP to grow until the second quarter of next year. Unemployment has been over 7%. It's contracting. It's the highest in 20 years. Inflation is slightly negative, minus 0.3%, and interest rates have never been lower. It's all the semblances, really, of a Keynesian liquidity trap in which conventional monetary policies have become impotent because nominal interest rates are or near zero. In that Keynesian context, money and bonds were basically worth the same. The federal government, with the assistance of the Reserve Bank, has adopted a number of measures aimed at lessening the impact of the recession and positioning the economy to recover quickly from what has been the sharpest economic downturn in our history. Through the JobKeeper and JobSeeker and a range of expenditures, the government has injected money into the system to lessen the impact of unemployment and considerable underemployment, and to try and promote growth through fiscal policies, a classical Keynesian stance, although I would argue it's not necessarily inconsistent with a monetary or a Friedman approach. We can look at this further on. The measures taken to date have been successful to the extent that they have anaesthetised the personal trauma that could be expected from such a downturn in the short term, but the future costs could be substantial. Let's look at some of the measures and their likely costs. Expenditures of the scale adopted by the government cannot be paid by immediate tax receipts, particularly in a recession. Therefore, the government must incur debt. The level of debt incurred has been unprecedented in the post-World War II period. The funding of government debt is largely through the sale of securities, sale to banks and general public, of course, mop up liquidity or idle reserves, and of course, do not necessarily mean they're deflationary or decrease the money supply. That really comes in with how the Reserve Bank buys up those securities, either directly, mostly indirectly through the general economy. Quantitative easing is a way of expressing it. Since the commencement of the pandemic and the associated lockdown here in Australia, credit growth has declined, as you'd expect in a recession. At the same time, money supply has increased. In fact, the difference between the growth in credit rates and money supply has never been greater in recent history, even during the GFC, when the money supply also expanded significantly. The easy money policies have so far failed to stimulate the economy, although they probably have muted the fall in GDP and have certainly caused some of the asset inflation that we're observing. Why is this, and why there's no evidence of CPI inflation? And I'd like to distinguish between asset inflation and CPI inflation. The press mostly focus on CPI inflation. People are risk averse and hold on to their money in a recession, not surprising. The savings rate among Australian households has been increasing and the velocity of circulation of money has declined. It would be stretching to say we're in a classical Keynesian liquidity trap, but certainly the response to easy money has been muted. To overcome this, the government is attempting to stimulate demand through tax cuts, easing access to superannuation funds, and removing restrictive lending conditions imposed on the banks. All these policies are likely to raise the ire of the political left because they weaken the power of government and the responsibility of the state relative to the individual in making decisions. Governments are also investing in infrastructure and socially desirable projects to stimulate demand, which has much more consensus amongst politicians. I could spend considerable time going through these issues, but I'm sure a number of them will come up. The RBA does not expect interest rates to rise significantly over the next 3 years. While some may rejoice in the continuation of easy money, it also signals there's no expectation of a rapid increase in demand for capital or investment. A lack of significant response and investment implies muted demand for the products of that investment. The economy, under such a scenario, is not going to make a V-shaped recovery. The world economy, still coping with the economics effect of COVID-19, it's very difficult to see the Australian economy recovering without some normalisation of trade and migration. The lockdown has created some new ways of conducting business. It stimulated the development of new services and products. It's difficult to see how we can return to where we were. I'm sure we're going to see quite a different set of circumstances and environment for business. The agency and frictional costs of adopting these changes are likely to also slow recovery. When the economy starts to grow, we can expect some return to inflation unless the growth is sufficiently great that it mops up the recent growth in money supply, which is unlikely. It's difficult for central banks to fine-tune inflation or control for inflation and inflationary expectations. Monetary policy is not like operating a faucet. Its effects are difficult to estimate, and timing is also critical and extraordinarily variable. Move too early, if the central banks move too early to constrain inflation, they'll be accused of cutting off the recovery. And if they move too late, of course, the net result will be inflation. I've already mentioned we've seen evidence of asset inflation, particularly in stock markets, where the weight of money accompanying low interest rates, which is a measure of the cost of capital or opportunity cost of capital, has led to stock prices returning to levels prior to the COVID-19 outbreak with accompanying high PEs. The price earnings ratio is an inverse of the real cost of capital for those companies. Property prices is more mixed, but given the level of interest rates and the amount of credit now available, in my opinion, it's difficult to see a major fall in property prices. If the growth of the economy is sufficiently large, optimistically, government debt could be paid by way of this growth and taxes. If we do not get that growth, and the debt will need repaying at some stage, or at least it can't continue to expand. The government deficit cannot continue indefinitely. This is in contradiction, of course, to some of those adherents of modern monetary theory, which at its extreme is fallacious. Under these circumstances, debt can really only be paid through taxes, inflation, or expropriation, which is, of course, the equivalent of defaulting. So all in all, not a very pleasant prospect going forward, but certainly one difficult to make any firm forecasts with. Thank you, Anton.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob. Thank you for anchoring the beginning of where we're going to head this evening. I'd now like to ask Anatole, as Chief Economist and Co-Chairman of Gavekal, to comment from a broader international perspective, and it provides us a bit of context as well for what we're seeing in Australia. So over to you, Anatole.
Thanks, Anton. Well, obviously, this is a truly global phenomenon in a way that we've never seen in previous cycles. So from the point of view of statistics and the depth of the collapse and so on, everything Bob Officer has just said about Australia applies to the world as a whole, but actually to an even greater degree, although Australia, by its structure, one would imagine to be one of the most cyclical economies of the world, you know, because of the dependence on natural resources and domestic residential properties prices, or residential property speculation, if you like. In fact, in this cycle, actually as in previous cycles, both America and Europe and much of Asia has experienced an even deeper cycle than in Australia. I'm not going to go into the numbers, which probably most of our listeners are aware of anyway, you know, of how the various regions have performed. But suffice it to say that for the world as a whole, this is the first time ever that we're actually going to see a negative growth of GDP, an actual decline of GDP in the world as a whole. This is the first time it's happened since modern economic statistics have been compiled, you know, since the 1960s and 1970s by the IMF and the OECD. And in that statistical sense, this is clearly a much deeper shock to the world, much bigger shock to the world economy than even the global financial crisis of 2008 and 2009. Despite that, the expectations, certainly in the financial markets and even in the business community, are not nearly as negative as they became after the 2008 crisis. And in fact, while a V-shaped recovery in real economic activity is in my view, like Bob's, unlikely, at least for the next year or two. There is certainly an uptick, but the right leg of the V shows no sign of actually reaching the sort of levels of actual, the levels of economic activity as opposed to the changes in economic activity are not going to get back to the sort of pre-crisis, pre-COVID output levels that we saw at the beginning of this year, at least for another 2 years and possibly as long as 3 years. Although there is no sign of that, and I think not much hope of that kind of V-shaped recovery in real economic activity, if you look at financial markets and asset prices in particular, in stock market prices in particular, the V-shape has already happened. There's been a full recovery, in fact, more than full recovery in a lot of asset prices around the world. So this is clearly a paradox, a puzzle about what has happened in the last 6 months, which I think at least gives some hints about or some possibilities about how this crisis may evolve, not just in the next few months, but over the next few years and really up to the end of the decade. And the way that I have found useful as a framework for looking at this crisis is to really think about it in terms of three very distinct time horizons. The short term, basically between now and the end of this year, the medium term, the outlook for next year and the year after, and then the long term, you know, what's likely to happen for the rest of the decade. And I think the reason we have to keep those three time horizons distinct in our minds is that what we're experiencing all over the world is completely unprecedented in the sense that, or to the extent that any previous experience and previous correlations, previous regressions, previous statistical relationships are not really relevant. They can't really guide us about what's going to happen. And it's unprecedented, not just in one, but in two ways, which are in themselves contradictory. On the one hand, we have an unprecedented collapse of economic activity caused not just by the public health crisis of COVID, but even more by the lockdowns, by the government reactions to that public health emergency. And this is, as I've already said, is we're well beyond any experience that the world has had, certainly since the 1930s. On the other hand, we have an unprecedented economic stimulus, both from monetary policy and, as Bob Officer said, from crucially from fiscal policy. And again, this is on a larger scale than anything we've seen before, even in wartime. Both the monetary expansion, the central bank balance sheet expansions, far bigger than what occurred after the GFC, but even more importantly, the fiscal policy. And I think here I very much agree with what Bob Officer said. I think in this situation, it's fiscal policy that is the key rather than monetary policy. Monetary policy, at least for the moment, can only play an accompanying role, because when you have a loss of personal incomes and loss of house of corporate cash flows, which is caused directly not by loss of confidence in the business sector or different expectations about long-term investment returns, but caused by laws which actually prevent people going out to work and businesses from operating, you cannot compensate for that loss of, or you can't really do anything about that loss of economic activity through monetary policy, through making credit more available, making money more available. The only thing that can be done is for governments to replace directly those household incomes and corporate revenues with government subventions, either through subsidies or tax cuts. So we have these two unprecedented events, which are in a kind of tug of war. On the one hand, you have a collapse much deeper than ever expected. And on the other hand, you have a monetary and crucially fiscal stimulus trying to compensate for that collapse. Now, going back to the three time horizons I was talking about, I think those two unprecedented events have very different relationships about which one will dominate, depending on whether we look at the next few months, the next few years, or the long term. In the short term, the collapse of economic activity clearly must dominate. That is a certainty. It's not even a prediction, because as I said, and as we all know, if governments actually forbid economic activity from taking place through lockdowns, there is no amount of monetary policy that can compensate for that. And even if fiscal policy does make up for the lost income, which it has to a large extent, especially in America, but also in continental Europe, you still don't generate economic activity because people are locked down in their homes. And this is what we're seeing today. And it looks like that's going to continue in one way or another until the end of the year, given that there is now a second wave of COVID occurring all over the world. In the medium term, however, when we start to look to next year and the year after, there is at least a high probability that the fiscal and monetary stimulus will start to dominate over the after effects of COVID collapse. Now, how firm you believe in that depends basically whether you think that Keynesian policies will work, at least in the short to medium term, or not. I tend to be a Keynesian, unlike Bob, who was educated under Milton Friedman. I was educated at Harvard under Ken Arrow, who was, and Samuelson, you know, at MIT, who were obviously the leading Keynesians of the period. So I tend to believe that the Keynesian stimulus will work at least for in the next year or two, after the normal lag of 9 to 12 or 18 months. And I think this is why the financial markets have rebounded as strongly as they can. Rather to my surprise, most participants in financial markets have suddenly rediscovered their faith in Keynesian economics. And whatever is happening this year, they're looking through that and they're anticipating a pretty strong recovery in growth all over the world by, let us say, the middle of next year. I think that's a high probability. The collapse is a certainty. It's already happened. The rebound next year is a high probability, but of course, it's not a certainty. One of the dangers of the current situation, especially with the stock markets now again rebounding to all-time highs, is that the financial markets are treating what I, as a Keynesian, believe is a high probability as if it's 100% certainty. And there is a risk that there will be disappointment next year if the rebound is less powerful than is currently being forecast by the IMF, World Bank, and other economic institutions, which are predicting next year to be probably the strongest growth the world has ever experienced in terms of GDP growth. Of course, from a much lower base, it still won't get back to where we were before the crisis, but a very rapid growth is predicted from next year onwards. As I say, I think that's a high probability, but perhaps the financial markets have got rather ahead of themselves in treating it as a near 100% certainty. Finally, let me say a few words about the long term, and then I'll stop. And obviously, we can discuss things in much greater detail in the debate that comes later. But beyond the next 2 years, let's say, when Keynesian economics will dominate, we then have to look at what are going to be the long-term implications of, or the permanent implications of this unprecedented flood of both monetary expansion from central banks, but also government money into the economy and the rise in debt levels all over the world. Now, here we're talking not about certainties or even probabilities, but merely, I think, about possibilities. And I think there are two distinct possibilities that we need to think about, although it's much too early to conclude which one of those or what combination of these two possibilities will be the outlook. On the one hand, there is the very clear possibility of higher inflation for the reasons that Bob Officer described. You have this enormous monetary expansion. Certainly, if you're a very traditional monetarist and you believe that there is an almost one-to-one correlation in the long term between monetary growth and inflation, it's very hard not to believe that there will be higher inflation coming through in the second half of the decade. But even if you take a more ambivalent view about that, the combination of government debt, unlimited government debt, and also a complete change in government policies towards on government spending and on debt levels, advance of modern monetary theory, or magic money trees, which are the same initials all over the world, makes it hard to believe that there won't be a more inflationary tendency, and that probably we are now at the end of a 40-year period, which started in the 1980s, of steadily declining inflation and interest rates around the world. So that's one possibility. But there is also another possibility, and this is where I'll end. It's possible that as well as somewhat higher inflation, we will also get stronger economic growth rather than weaker economic growth in the world economy. Not just next year in the rebound, but over the next 5, 10, 15 years. And the basis for that is really the Keynesian belief that over the last 20 or 30 years, central banks in particular, but governments also around the world, have directed their demand management policies above all to suppressing inflation and generating economic growth and lowering unemployment, maintaining low levels of unemployment, full employment, has been a secondary consideration for policymakers all over the world. The US being a partial exception in the last few years, Australia also being a partial exception. You haven't had a recession for 30 years, but in most of the world, in Europe in particular, you've had extremely deflationary policies dominating really since the 1980s for the last 40 years. That consensus really seems to have changed, and we seem to be on the verge of a regime change back towards a more 1950s, early 60s style of Keynesian economics, where fiscal policy is directed to generating growth, lowering unemployment. Monetary policy supports that fiscal policy by financing government debt, even at the cost of somewhat higher inflation. And in addition to that, you have a phenomenon very similar like the post-war period, where government debts are so high all over the world, or will be so high by the middle of next year, that really the only way to reduce them is by generating much higher levels, either of inflation or real growth, or some combination through nominal growth, than we've seen over the last 40 years. So I think there's at least a possibility to which we should keep our minds open, that actually it will not just be inflation that is higher in by the second half of this decade, but also real economic activity all over the world, and particularly, I would say, in Europe, but also in the United States, may well be higher in a similar pattern to the one that we saw in the post-war period, 1950s and early 1960s. Of course, the danger is, as Bob suggested, that you move straight from the depression of the 1930s to the inflation, to the rapid inflation of the late 1960s and early 70s. That is definitely a possibility. But as I say, the other possibility is that in the interim, you have 5, 10, 15, or maybe even as much as 20 years of a Keynesian golden age.
Thank you, Anatole. Just to pick up on that last point around inflation, I guess earlier you were saying that later in the decade we can expect to see higher inflation, and I guess there's also a role talking about whether governments might actively encourage that inflation, particularly in dealing with the debt, which Bob mentioned as well. How do we navigate that vector of inflation in terms of what passively might occur over the coming years versus the level of active management of that, given the long flow-through effects monetary policy?
Well, I think if you're asking me, I think governments are actually already in the business of encouraging higher inflation. And actually, they have been in that business for the last 10 years. In fact, if you look at the way the monetary policy has been conducted all over the world since the global financial crisis, it's been distinctly and dramatically different from the 30 years before the financial crisis. The 30 years before the financial crisis, central banks all over the world consistently kept the short-term policy rate above the rate of inflation, except for very brief periods during recession. So you had real interest rates, even at the short end of the yield curve, averaging about 1.6% in the US and, you know, similar numbers all over the world for the 35-year period from 1980 until 2008-09. In the last 10 years, that's been completely reversed all over the world, led by the Bank of Japan, but then by the Fed and the European Central Bank. You've had interest rates kept significantly below, admittedly, a very low rate of inflation. And that meant that central banks were actually trying to nudge inflation upwards rather than downwards. Now they have, now governments have a reason to do that in addition to the central bank inflation targets, which is, and the reason is, to get the real level of their debts under control and eventually get them declining. So I think that is going to occur. And that's why I think somewhat higher inflation is inevitable. But I think the question is whether you get gradually and slightly higher inflation combined with stronger economic activity, which would be the Keynesian golden age hope, or whether you go straight to significantly higher inflation and still weak or even weaker economic activity. In other words, the kind of stagflation of the late 60s and early 70s, which would be the worst possible scenario. And I think, in my view, the jury is still out and will have to remain out on that at least for the next couple of years.
Thank you. Bob, do you think the Treasurer was correct to invoke Thatcher and Reagan in response to that risk discussed a couple of months ago around stagflation?
It's not an analogy I'd have used, but I certainly believe that you want to governments, as Anatole told us, have got no option at the moment but to have expenditures, particularly in infrastructure and the like. Governments, in my view, are not the best at running parts of the economy. They're better off, in effect, once they put these things into place, privatise them. And that means bringing markets into effect. And if you relate that to what happened under Reagan and Thatcher, then I agree. That's a sensible way of doing it. The trick is going to be in the transition. There's no question governments and their debt are going to command a lot more of the economy. The percentage of GDP now in debt is something like 46%. It's very high. Experience, and I've been a bureaucrat and I've been on the other side, experience tells me that if you really want to run these organisations, entities efficiently, you do what you can to put as much as you can into a competitive private sector market. What we're going through in Victoria is a good example of that, the problems of having too much state involvement and single directional decision making.
Are you concerned that the fiscal policies and the easy monetary policy has resulted in negative 0.3% inflation, as you mentioned?
It's resulted in, sorry?
The slight deflationary figure.
The deflationary figure at the moment is a reflection of risk. I know it's not fashionable to talk about the quantity equation, but it's an identity. The difficulty is, of course, the velocity. And Friedman always highlighted this. I don't see anything substantially contradictory in what's going on at the moment. If you read Friedman and Schwartz's monetary history of the US, you'll see they're very critical of the 30s and the monetary policy adopted there, where they tightened up at the wrong times. I think you need kickstarts the economy. If you can do it directly through the private sector, and of course there's some attempt with tax reductions and the like, The highlight I'd point to here is we tend to focus on consumer price indexes when we're talking inflation. Asset prices are inflation or inflationary at the moment. And that's partly because, of course, PEs are high. Earnings, expected earnings aren't that high. People say the market's overvalued. In the context of real interest rates, I don't believe that's sustainable. What I'm observing, and particularly at the level of the companies that I'm, there's a spate of IPOs coming on and a lot of money going towards new developments, new companies, new technologies, particularly the development of IT and the like. Those sort of things I think are important. I do think they'll take time to bring to fruition. I would hope, by Anatole, that it's earlier rather than later. But we'll have to wait and see.
Just on that point, perhaps Anatole, you might want to come in as well. Of Friedman and Schwartz's critique of monetary policy in the US. In Australia, there's been a narrative, an economic narrative around, Friedman economics versus Keynesianism. And Bobby, are you saying that, the point that's been left out is around the velocity of money, but is there as much of a gap in terms of the response we've been seeing from the Australian government to the crisis over the course of the year, as perhaps we might have thought before the crisis?
Well, I think a bit like politics, people like to paint oppositions into extreme conditions. Although I did Friedman's course, I'm a financial economist, so I'm not holding myself out as the ultimate expert on Friedman economics. But I attended his seminars and I did his course, and I think in this environment, he would be warning us certainly against inflation and the rapid increase in the money supply. But in terms of kick-starting an economy, you resort to whatever you think is going to be most effective. And I can see good reasons for, as I presume we'll see in tonight's budget, expenditures. It's the problem is with these sorts of particularly job seeker payments is how do you extract yourself out of those conditions. You can't keep going forever on that, despite what MMT might encourage people to think you can. And the deeper and the longer you take to start to pull back from that, the bigger the problem you're going to have further on. There's certainly major social issues, and I don't think people pull back from looking after some of those issues. You've got to cover off on it, I think, in terms of the equity issue is realistic. But I personally believe the empirical evidence on tax cuts, for example, which has come in for quite a lot of criticism, the empirical example in recent years is they have been stimulatory to the economy. It may be that those who are getting most of it aren't putting that on immediate consumption, but they are investing it. And of course, we can go back to the old French economist Say and Say's law that supply creates own demand. Now, you've got to be a bit careful how you interpret that in the context I'm talking about. But nonetheless, I think it's an empirical issue. And I am not one of those who thinks that these tax cuts are wasted on the wealthy, insofar as those with wealth create industries and that creates jobs, products, etc. So it's a chicken or the egg thing, and I think you can come at this both ways.
Thank you. Professor Gigi Foster, hearing some of the comments that we've been talking about so far, it'd be good to hear your thoughts, your response, but also you've worked theoretically in an area of economics that goes beyond, I guess, what a lot of the understanding of economics is in the broader public discourse. And perhaps you'd like to sort of bring in that, because a lot of people are saying that the pandemic, COVID-19, the economic shock that it's caused is also a watershed moment to look at opportunities for doing things differently, for thinking differently, and for opportunity. So, you know, whether that's kind of the model of Homo economicus and individual action, or whether there's scope for more cooperation. So your thoughts, Gigi, and perhaps if you can sort of share with us some of your theoretical insights into how we might expand our vision of thinking about the economy going forward.
Sure. Well, thank you very much for inviting me for this talk, Anton. And there's just so much going through my head in reaction to the first two speakers and in reaction to what we spoke about earlier. I'm not sure even where to start, but I'll try to cover off on those points that you'd like me to cover. I'll start by talking about my own formal education, since the first two speakers mentioned that. So I got my PhD at the University of Maryland in public economics and labor economics under Judy Hellerstein. But really, the more, I suppose, influential formal education that I had was at Yale University, where I studied economics not on its own, but in a combined major called Ethics, Politics, and Economics. And I believe that sort of contextualized study of economics really colors my work today. So most people who look at my CV will say that I'm a behavioral economist. I've studied a lot of things, education policy, other kinds of policies, time use, a lot of econometrics early in my career, and now I do some behavioral economics in the field and some theory of behavioral economics. And I suppose certainly the biggest contribution that I feel I've made in that field is in a book that was published in 2013 with my colleague Paul Freiters at the LSE, which is called An Economic Theory of Greed, Love, Groups, and Networks. And in that book, we essentially try, first of all, to set out what mainstream economic theory sees as the core workhorse model of the individual decision maker, deciding how to allocate resources, and indeed the model of what the government should, if it is benevolent towards its citizens, be interested in doing. And this actually aligns quite well with what came up with the second speaker tonight, which is that government should be interested in essentially promoting the efficient usage of all the resources in the economy, which includes full employment, for example, to the extent that we can get there, and certainly not having idle capital or other resources sitting around. You want everything to be used in some sense so that you can produce as much as you can, as much, you know, bang as you can get from the given bucks that you have. And bucks is not just money. It's human resources and material resources and assets. And there is a very, you know, strong argument in public economics, one of my fields in university when I was studying for my PhD, which says that the government does have a very important role to play in setting up a society for the efficient use of those resources by the private sector. It is in the private sector that we see the largest amount of growth, the largest fortunes are made there, innovation occurs there, you know, employment is stimulated in the private sector by virtue of private sector decision making. But that decision making is all predicated upon expectations of those operating in those industries. And this theme of expectations is something that has come through in both of the first two speakers. And expectations are a very, very fluid, intangible sort of thing. And if you're not an economist, it's a bit, maybe, it may sound a bit fluffy to be talking about, you know, expectations. Well, you know, what do you think is going to happen in the future? It is unbelievably important to the decision-making of individuals and firms what their expectations are of what's going to happen tomorrow, the short run, the medium run, and the long run. And in Australia today, one of the big problems we have is that people do not know what to expect. There is a great deal of uncertainty, which is caused partly by the uncertainty related to the virus, but I would say mainly now to do with their uncertainty in relation to what is the government going to do, not just in relation to spending, but in relation to policies, in relation to border closings, in relation to restrictions on your activity in a particular state, border closings, not just domestically, but also internationally. These things make a huge difference to what people can expect for their future. And so just as a development economist will say that stability and certainty are things that we wish to bring to the developing world in order to stimulate investment, so too, in Australia and other developed economies, would we say that certainty and stability and an ability to form an expectation about what's going to happen in the future that we're reasonably confident of is a stimulus to investment. And those expectations are also built not just on what we think the government is going to do, but on what we think everybody else in the economy is going to do. And this is because one of the big inputs to economic productivity and output generally is something, again, very intangible, which we don't have great measures of compared to capital and labor, which are the traditional inputs we talk about when we teach first year economics. And that is network links. The links between employers and employees, the links between customers and their suppliers and upstream suppliers to downstream suppliers, and the possibility set that exists for each individual operating in the interdependent economy to potentially change their supplier or change their customer or change the person whom they're trading with in any given market, if necessary, if the circumstances demand it or seem to require it. So when there is a general recessionary climate, as there now is because of our policies, particularly in Australia now for 6 months or 8 months now, it means that there are going to be fewer people out there in the world who could be potential network partners for any individual, whether it's an individual thinking about spending or working in the economy and in the labor market, or whether it's a company leader or someone running his own business who needs to choose where to get his supplies and whom to sell to. And so his expectations about who is in that network, the potential network and the real network right now, are going to feed into his decisions about whether to invest and whether to hire more people and all these kinds of things. And so what the government really needs to do, in my view now, is to recognize the importance of those expectations in its policy. So what I'd like to see as part of the budget is a movement of the government to try to encourage investment through its expenditures, physical expenditures, which have to this point mainly been focused on supporting that aggregate demand, as we spoke about earlier. So, the JobKeeper program, for example, which I was a big supporter of when it first came out, essentially because I saw it as a life raft, a preservation mechanism for those links, right, between employers and employees. And if we only had shut down for 2 weeks or even a month, then we could have simply gone back into business and had those links still working. Now that we're 8 months into this, a lot of those links are no longer going to be viable. So we've been supporting at least some of the things we've been supporting have been zombie jobs that won't actually make it through the other side of this tunnel that we've created for ourselves. And so rather than having that kind of a sort of charitable propping up in the short run kind of attitude, I'd like to see government programs transition more towards stimulating investment. And one of the best packages I've seen for that is something that was actually invented here in Australia and for our university education expenditures, and has been exported around the world to many other countries. It was invented by Bruce Chapman, a professor at the ANU, and it's a revenue contingent loan scheme. So rather than having handouts, the government can offer loans, and this could be loans to the small and medium-sized business sector, or it could also be to individuals themselves. And those loans are repaid only if revenues, in the case of companies, or incomes, in the case of individuals, rise above a certain threshold at a certain point in the future. And if designed well, programs like that, which we already use, as I say, in our higher education system, it's called HECS, the Higher Education Contribution Scheme, can actually be, generally speaking, recouped, not 100%, but very close to 100% by the government. And it provides a mechanism to take all that downside risk, all of that negative sort of thought about what if, that prohibits people from making investment decisions today, takes that downside risk onto the shoulders of the government. And then it just leaves the individual or the company with a little more liquidity and the opportunity to do those kinds of investments that may be beneficial. And of course, a scheme like this has to be designed well so that it's not just considered a handout, and we have to select the right companies and the right people and have the levels of loans correct. But I think that kind of policy, I would love to see it in the budget. I doubt that I will. And let me then lead into then, what do I think the government should be doing more of in the future, and what are we missing in the sorts of traditional economic models that we've used to this point? So one of the themes in my book, An Economic Theory of Loyalty, and the unseen motivations that those phenomena produce in our hearts, in our minds. So when we are loyal to our family, for example, that motivates us to want to feed our children, to want to support our spouse, to want to be an upstanding citizen, to be a role model, etc. Those kinds of motivations don't really make it into standard economics that we teach to our undergraduates. Of course, they do occasionally make it into upper level electives and some people's PhD theses, but it's not part of the standard story. And yet we know that love and loyalty are massive drivers if you look inside yourself. Of course, they are massive drivers of the decisions that you make every day. And while greed does explain a huge amount of human decision-making, particularly in the medium run, and that's why economics has rightly earned the moniker of the queen of the social sciences, why we speak to the right hand of politicians worldwide, because our model is basically the best that's been produced in social science, in my view, for predicting behavior and trying to guide resource allocation decision-making, it still is not a complete model. And you can tell that by looking at the parts of humans that are simply not in the mainstream model. So one of the big things that has occurred over the last 200 years is that humanity has hit upon the most effective way of organizing humans that we've ever seen, which is the nation state. And of course, in Australia, as in other countries that have a successful nation state model, a large role of that national sort of personification of this government is to provide things to its citizens. And the citizens, knowing that the government is going to provide for them and that they sort of own it, they feel a loyalty towards that country, right? So there's a nationalism or a patriotism, which did not exist in the time before nation states, right? We had loyalty to individual rulers, but we did not have loyalty to an entity like the nation state. And what we've seen in this recession, and this happens in many times of turmoil and particularly economic distress, is that those feelings of support for the country and support for other citizens and a notion of us in a country has been somewhat, those feelings have been somewhat harmed. They've suffered some trauma from the fact that, in fact, the individual on the street doesn't see the government doing as much for them. They're more worried. They're worried that, their children kept out of school are now having mental health issues. They're worried that their husband has lost his job. They're worried that, they don't have as much income to cover the various expenditures they need. They can't get out of the country to visit, overseas for whatever purpose. They're feeling stressed and their needs aren't being as well met by the country. And if you want to read the book, you'll find our theory of love and loyalty. One of the things in there is that to generate love and loyalty and to sustain it, the lover or the one who's being loyal does need to see some evidence that the external entity to which they're loyal is providing things that the lover or person who is loyal desires. And so, I don't like seeing all the fractiousness and all of the strife inside countries. We've seen the riots in the U.S. And here as well, all of the, various different internal tensions that are really drawing us apart from each other and are a distraction from being able to put our resources towards their most effective and efficient use, which will promote human welfare. Because at the end of the day, economics is about the promotion of human welfare, full stop. It is not about money. It is not about exchange rates. It is not about any particular thing other than let's figure out how to set up a society in such a way that we get the maximum human welfare out of the resources that we have. And that is just, I think, the most unassailable definition of economics and our objective in economics I've seen. And I live by that. I teach my students that. And that is, as much as it can be clouded by our discussions of monetary aspects and expenditures and unemployment rates and whatnot, at the end of the day, that is the objective that we're going for. So as an economist and someone who sees the importance of the organizational system and the loyalties that underpin it, I'd like to see more support for in the budget for a role of government to truly help its citizens in ways that will not just be seen as handouts and essentially make the citizens more dependent on the government, but basically offer a leg up to individuals and to companies that can then provide jobs and innovation and drive the economy forward. So this is why I like the revenue contingent loan scheme idea. I also, just as a sort of side note, I think that there are other things the government can do that would be helpful to see in the budget, which would also feed that sort of direction of moving towards a government which is truly seen to be providing for its people. And one of them, of course, is infrastructure, yes. But I don't think it's as much the shiny brass knob sorts of projects that I'd like to see. It's much more repair to existing infrastructure, not the boondoggle projects. For example, we had a project which may not be as familiar to the UK audience, but the Sydney Light Rail, which now is got the moniker of the Sydney Light Fail, because it's essentially seen as a bit of a boondoggle, a large, you know, really big infrastructure project that caused years of disruption and really wasn't actually needed and now takes actually twice as long to get from my university downtown than the buses that were already there. Right? So it's just a completely silly project, but it was the outcome of, you know, the sorts of gray gift exchange sort of dealings that we often see in Australian industries. If anybody's interested about that, you can read it all about it in a book that came out a few years ago called Game of Mates, How Favors Bleed the Nation. So those kinds of projects, they're really good for politicians' careers. They're really good for the particular industries involved. And the big companies usually are the ones who get those sorts of contracts. But they aren't actually that helpful for promoting welfare of everybody. And welfare of everybody is what we're going for here. Not just the rich, not just the poor, everybody. And so the kinds of infrastructure that I would like to see include things, for example, like social housing, which I don't think we have enough of. And I think we could do a much better job subsidizing and incentivizing through private mechanisms, but with government support, the building of well-located social housing and the uptake of that housing by, you know, the kinds of people who we really are targeting for it. I also, and this may be somewhat controversial, but I also think that the government could do a very, very good service to the country by embarking on a program of providing universal basic childcare. Okay. This is done already in European countries to great effect, and it's a triple benefit to the country. First of all, it creates jobs, including in the regions, and these are good jobs that will always essentially be there because we always have children. Secondly, you are taking pressure off of labor today in the form of liberating working families, young working families, and distressed parents as well, including, you know, young mothers and anybody who's having trouble dealing with their children in a disadvantaged situation, and they can then be much more participatory in the labor market. And thirdly, of course, we are directly investing in the future productivity and welfare of Australia. So I think that universal basic childcare is a great idea. And I do actually agree that just having a government option is not so great. I actually favor a mix.
Okay. I'll take that as a strong list of recommendations from you around childcare, infrastructure, and trying to create sort of productive jobs as well. Bearing in mind your concern around zombie jobs. So it'd be interesting to sort of see the response of others around how do we make sure that we're dealing with what the Reserve Bank came out today as saying that employment is the, you know, is really the one of the top national priorities. And I think that reflects what Anatole was saying as a sort of shifting consensus that the crisis created as well. And this sort of concern around zombie jobs. I'm not sure that you know, there are different opinions about that sort of zombie job, zombie company concern versus the, as you say, the importance of networks and the loyalty to the country and groups and what the breakages in those network links will do. And presumably unemployment will have a huge impact on the breakages of those network links and loyalty within the country, as you mentioned. Just like to go to Jack. Jack, if you have a few thoughts on what we might do longer term to come out of the crisis brought upon us by COVID-19, and you know how we might actually start to create the growth that Anatole was talking about, and ensure that one of the things I think one of the questions online has been around productivity. Productivity, as we know, has been declining globally in advanced economies for a long time before COVID-19. And that's certainly something that we need to focus on in the mix of all this going forward. So, Jack, what are your thoughts on creating the future out of this?
Thank you, Anton, and thank you to the other speakers. I won't repeat what some of the many interesting thoughts. I'll try to add some new things. And firstly, you know, whilst this discussion has been predominantly economically based, I just goes without saying, deep empathy to the many individuals and families who've been, you know, adversely impacted by COVID, and let's hope that improves as soon as possible. So the way I approached this subject matter is that I think we're in the early innings of what I call the Great Convergence, where by 2030, we're going to have 70% of the world's population who will be millennial or Gen Z globally. That's 5 billion people who by 2030 will be 18 to 49. This will occur at the same time that we see the biggest intergenerational wealth transfer in history of around $40 trillion. And that consumer, the younger consumer, thinks in a very different way to their parents' generation and to many of the leaders today. So I think COVID economically has brought forward and accelerated many of the trends that this consumer of tomorrow considers second nature. Subject matters like the green revolution, technological architecture, another billion Asian consumers, and personalized healthcare. But other questions I think we should be focused on include, how do we feed 9 billion people at a point when only 20% of countries have self-sufficiency in food? So when you combine a number of these themes, I think it's highly possible that this convergence creates a product replacement cycle, unleashes consumer spending, and results in a reallocation of asset flows that we haven't seen comparably for decades, which I think is, you know, cause for optimism and excitement. And in terms of unlocking industries of the future and attracting human capital, I'm a proud Australian and now a dual British citizen, having lived in the UK for more than a decade. But Australia is known for many things around the world, and our pension and superannuation system is one of those. We have close to $3 trillion, and by 2035, on conservative numbers, that will grow to around $10 trillion. If we were to hypothetically take 1% of that $3 trillion today, $30 billion, and invest it in industries of the future, this would be the equivalent of 20 times greater than what the Prime Minister proposed a week or so ago that will be announced in the budget later today of investment in new industries, 20 times greater. Now, I can't speak on behalf of all Australians clearly, but Australians are incredibly intelligent, patriotic, and I think if you said to most people, would you take 1% of your pension to invest in new industries that will create jobs, to the point Gigi mentioned, may accelerate that network effect, and to what Bob and Anatole mentioned about paying off debt, that may actually put Australia in a really competitive position for the future, I think many people would embrace that. And equally, this ties to industries where we have expertise, like agriculture, where we can export a lot of that intelligence in new technologies such as vertical farming, which have an environmentally different footprint, and other sectors also. So I'm cautiously optimistic about the future, because I think we're at this juncture where many exciting ideas are coming together. I think due to fiscal management over the past 15 years, I think Australia should now borrow money. I think people want to live in the present, and debt is something we, you know, discuss at length in this country, but with interest rates the lowest they've ever been, you know, we're Australians, let's have a go and let's try and make that investment for the future generations, because that millennial and Gen Z consumer is far more environmentally conscious. They're far more globally orientated. They're far more technologically plugged in, and we have the financial resources to do it, so I really think we should. And I think constructive discussion like this, you know, a global and local perspective, is really helpful in sharing those ideas, because we can learn from other countries about what they've done better, you know, and we can cherry pick those ideas. One of the benefits of having a smaller economy with a massive landmass, as we all know, is that pivoting is not as difficult to some of our peers, right? Currently, our superannuation, 50% of the incremental flows go offshore, and much of that to Silicon Valley. I love my American friends, but let's look at getting something for that investment beyond a return, or building industries domestically. So I think it's a really, despite the challenging health situation we have, an economic scenario, I think it's rational to be an optimist. And I think we should use this opportunity to our advantage to really position Australia for the future and bring together the best ideas we can, because these periods in history, as we know, often reflect periods of inflection. So now's the time to really seize that opportunity.
Thanks, Jack. And we've talked about some of the ideas that have been in flux over the course of the year in terms of managing the pandemic and the economy. We've also got, as another point of variation, technology itself and technology as a challenge, if you like, to the monetary system that operates internationally. And Jeremy's had a long career with Barclays Bank, is now focusing on distributed ledger technologies and the impact that they are going to have in terms of the financial system, and obviously a technology that's applicable more broadly too. So Jeremy, what are your thoughts in terms of the implications of blockchain for the management of the economy at this point in time, in terms of the weakness that we see globally and the future of distributed ledger technologies in terms of the international financial system?
Great. Thanks very much. Thank you, Anton. This has been a really interesting session, actually, and I'm honoured to be part of it. I think what I'll do, I'm going to slightly switch the thrust of what I was planning to say, but I'll keep to the essence of it. I'll talk a bit about blockchain, Anton, and but largely the derivatives, what comes out as a result of the use of blockchain within the engine. I have to say, I share the general optimism that I think it seems to be coming out of this particular panel about where we're going. I think, you know, we have a major transformation underway on this planet now, which has been accelerated by COVID. I always tend to look at these in terms of three major influences and possibly a fourth. The first is and I think it is becoming critically important, is just how we sustain life on the planet. The second is this phenomenal technological revolution we're going through. The third is a fairly pronounced geopolitical shift that seems to be taking place. And I suppose the fourth, which has come onto the radar, is the health of the species. Now, one of the great accelerants of this particular crisis, or the area where which this crisis seems to have stimulated, is the use of new technologies. And I wanted to use two specific examples, because I think some areas of technology have now foundering and they're not moving any further forward. All these new technologies, bear in mind, are interacting increasingly with each other. So they're producing what is effectively almost a new operating system, maybe, for want of a better word. But within that operating system, some things are moving forward faster than others. The first thing which has been accelerated is all the technologies behind tracking and tracing of individuals. I don't want to spend a huge amount of time on it. I suspect blockchain will come to play a significant part in it, but it is profoundly important because, of course, it is pushing the boundaries of privacy and civil liberty way beyond any points that would have been countenanced in March this year. We have yet to see the full impact of that as it moves forward. The second point I wanted to example, if you like, that I wanted to pick on of technology that is moving forward post-COVID and does have a blockchain base to it is, of course, the development of digital currencies. Now, this really, I suppose you could say, started, didn't it, with the world of Bitcoin and Libra. But when it became apparent just how potent this technology was going to be, of course, the central banks, acting on behalf of their governments, picked this up immediately, because the potential for a real global currency accessible to all by all starts to completely undermine monetary sovereignty. Now, there are some real experts in this on this particular panel, so I need to be careful as to how far down this road I go. But I think it is no accident that what has now happened, of course, is the central banks have picked up this phenomenon and are beginning to move it forward. There are, last I heard, I think over 80 central banks around the world now have projects concentrating on it. But in addition to that, there is a growing realization that whilst you can't necessarily have a global digital currency or cryptocurrency, I mean, all currency and money is digital these days, not all of it, but most of it. When I talk about digital currency, I'm referring to the technology beneath it, which enables a particular unit of money to carry a tremendous amount of data with it and so on.
Jeremy, just a question. Do you see the Chinese digital currency that's being issued as a threat to the US dollar system internationally?
I think Anton, actually, you've anticipated my first point, probably in an attempt to, right, to hurry me along. So why don't I just sort of finish on this point? It is interesting that the central bank now, its digital currency, I think the deputy governor said yesterday of the People's Bank of China said yesterday, there are now 3 million people using digital currencies internally within China as part of its pilot schemes. I think it's across 4 cities and $2 billion worth of transactions that are being pumped through the system. They are way ahead of others in the use of this and the development of this currency as it moves forward. They're pushing it increasingly down the Belt and Road, and I think they're beginning to see, and we're all beginning to see, the use of a parallel currency for the renminbi, which by its universality and its nature represents a serious alternative to the dominance of a global reserve currency. And in this particular case, of course, the dominant global reserve currency is the US dollar. That process is clearly going to take time, but if the monetary order and the monetary system is stressed and stretched by the crisis we've got at the moment, I suspect we'll see a considerable acceleration in that process. And it's not yet high enough on, in my personal view, on government agendas in the Western economies yet. It's good. The Bank of England, for example, has shown very encouraging interest in the direction this is going. But I don't see it in Downing Street. And I have to say, I don't see it in the White House. Mm. So, Anton, why don't I stop there? Because I'm conscious, I haven't looked at my clock.
Sure.
But
just a brief question to pick up on that as well. These alternative currencies are something, as you mentioned, that the central banks around the world have been following. But do you see these alternative currencies as a threat to the central banks of countries, or as an augmentation in terms of the suite of currencies and assets that they can manage?
I think they're both a threat and an opportunity, and they're an opportunity, Anton, in the sense that, as Bob was saying earlier on, I think, and Anatole mentioned it too, you really do, competition is a very healthy thing to have, and these alternative currencies definitely stimulated an interest on the part of governments to protect what we all need, which is a stable monetary system. So in the long run, Anton, I think probably what will happen is that these alternative currencies will be useful to individual communities and constituencies. Some of them may well be global. But actually the system, if it's going to hold together, will have to bow to the greater enforcement, it doesn't sound like the right words, by governments, of their own form of digital currency to hold the order together.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jeremy. We've only got a couple of minutes left, so I just like to ask everyone, I mean, I think a couple of the things that will be talked about this evening are likely to sort of revolve around what tax cuts on the one hand and the continuation of programs such as JobKeeper or alternatives that are going to, I guess, politically communicate a sense of stability and certainty, as Gigi mentioned, into the future. So I'm just wondering if you'd like to just mention as a panel your final thoughts on what you'd like to see and what you think maybe is not so important to see in the budget that we'll hear from the federal government tonight. Bob, would you like to start?
I think I've more or less covered that. I was particularly interested in Jeremy's points because I think he's dead right. The only, and it's really a question, I suppose, Jeremy, when people have asked me about cryptocurrencies, it's really for governments to lose their role as a, you know, when they debase their own currency, that's when you'll get them coming in. But the system, of course, of blockchain, I think, is a wonderful structure and much broader than the cryptocurrencies. But until a cryptocurrency, you can pay your taxes with one, I have worries about the backing and the acceptability of one. Would you care to comment?
Yes, Bob. And I think my immediate reaction is this is not going to happen overnight. This is a lengthy process. The most striking thing about the crisis, certainly in the UK recently, was that if we had had these cryptocurrencies or these digital currencies in action, we would have been able, a government here would have been able to direct financial support with forensic accuracy to individual citizen communities. Now, that's not collection of tax, Bob, I understand that. But we do, the Whitechapel think tank does quite a lot of work with HMRC, the revenue, the tax authorities here in the UK. And it is quite clear that they're thinking along those lines as well. So I'm wondering now whether specific use cases for a currency will start to develop themselves in response to specific needs. In a way, that's what Facebook did with Libra. I think if central banks start to concentrate on that and governments start to concentrate on it, maybe that is the direction we go, which moves us towards universal acceptance. One thing I think I'm growing increasingly confident about is that we have a new form of money here. And although all forms of money seem to run in parallel, I think probably that this one is going to, over the next 40, 50 years, assume a very powerful dominant position because of all its additional functionality. I don't know if that answers your question, Bob, but
I think you're Jack, right. Is there anything you'd like to see in the budget tonight to support the future that you're talking about, just very briefly?
Yeah, I'll keep it brief, Anton. Thank you. Yeah, so I would just encourage the government to think beyond a six-month prism. If we look at some of the major industries in this country, there are risks to the incumbents, but they also create opportunities. So, for example, plant-based foods is a $500 billion a year opportunity on my maths. Telehealth, healthcare is 13% of our GDP, 13% of all employment, yet telehealth is only 2% of all medical activities. And 60% of Asian tradies intra-Asia, and we're going to have another 1 billion people in Asia enter the middle class. Let's plug into those thematics so the future generations, which we always talk about, can benefit from those and it can create great prosperity for many people in this country.
Thanks. Gigi, you mentioned social housing, infrastructure, and universal childcare. Is there any final thoughts you'd like to put out?
Well, just two things really quickly. One is just to spruik again the revenue contingent loan idea. I'd like to see a plan like that. I don't think I will. I'd love to see it though. And just on Jack's idea to take 1% of future superannuation balances. In fact, Australia's superannuation system is incredibly inefficient by worldwide standards. So 1% of the stock of superannuation balances on average is creamed off the top every year by our fund managers. And that compares unfavorably to the best in class, which is in Norway, where it costs 0.1%. So if we could simply get a better superannuation structure, perhaps with some tightenings up in various ways in that sector, or possibly the option of a government-sponsored option, or indeed individual retirement account type system, which we have in the US, we could find that money immediately and put it into these kinds of investments that Jack would like to see.
Thanks, Gigi. And Anatole, you've seen many policy responses around the world. What would you like to see in the Australian budget tonight?
Well, you know, I'm not going to comment on Australia, where I haven't lived since I was 14 years old, but I did, indirectly, I will, because I wanted to follow on from points made by Gigi and Jack in particular. You know, I was talking about the potential for this higher growth period as a result of the regime change and demand management towards more emphasis on growth and jobs rather than suppressing inflation. one of the other reasons why there was such an enormous and unprecedented growth period after the Second World War, of course, was the post-war reconstruction of Europe and Japan. Now, a lot of people say, well, that was the real cause of the rapid growth in the Keynesian Golden Age rather than the demand management. That may well be, but I think what we're actually on the brink of is another period, as Jack described, of potentially enormous investment. In fact, much larger if you think about what it will entail to transform the world's energy and transport systems alone, even without agriculture and many, many other sectors as, and currencies, as Jack and Jeremy described. These are investments on a scale far larger even than the reconstruction of Europe and Japan after the Second World War. So I think there is potential for enormously more rapid growth over the next 10, 15, 20 years than the expectations which are based on the period from 1980 to 2008, which has actually been a very weak period of economic activity around the world. So I would say combining the regime change in monetary and fiscal policy with the environmental infrastructure and psychological changes that are occurring at a rapid pace, at an accelerated pace now, I think does at least open up the possibility that the next few decades will be stronger than the last few decades rather than weaker, which is almost what almost everybody is currently expecting.
Thanks, Anatole. Could we quickly just have a show of hands on screen about whether in 12 months' time you're optimistic about where we're heading from this point? Are you optimistic about the future in a year's time?
Yeah. Well, there we are.
We've got pretty close to a full showing.
Is there an alternative?
A little bit more uncertain. I mean,
I'm not I really.
Things are so bad they can't get much worse.
Well, it's been a very interesting and diverse discussion covering a really wide range of perspectives. And I thank you all very much for sharing your thoughts with us this evening. And hopefully it's some thoughts that are fuel for considering the budget that comes down later tonight as well. So thank you very much and goodbye.